Hi, everybody. Welcome for this new Jenkins infrastructure meeting. Today, to the agenda, we're going to talk about repo.jenkinsia.org, the new digital HCN accounts, the Rackspace accounts, some ongoing work with ci.jenkins.io and Docker with the Arch. So let's start with the GFrog thing. So last Friday, we had a meeting with GFrog. So just to go back, I'm not sure if I shared So I wrote some notes during the meeting. So just to come back on what happened. During the last security release, we had issues to do the security release. We had issue to promote artifacts from the staging environment to the production environment. While that thing has been solved, what we discovered was we were using an undersized database. So we had some like issues on the number of connection. So the only thing that GFrog did was to increase the size of the database so we could have more connection on database connection. But the second thing that we noticed was it took us 1 hour to copy the artifact instead of say several seconds initially. So we engaged with GFrog support. We engaged with GFrog support, and we had a session last week where we debug. What we have to understand there is what we did was to just increase the level of logging on the service, and then Said, who was a person who helped us on last Friday, will investigate on this side. So right now we still don't understand what's happening and why it took 1 hour to copy the artifact, but we hope to have a better understanding in the coming week. So that's the state. I'll put a link to the meeting notes here. It's a markdown document. So I have it here. Any question? Sounds good. The next step is once I have more information, we should plan another meeting with them, and I hope we'll find a good solution. The next topic that I want to talk about that I'm pretty excited is DigitalOcean offered us to sponsor some machines. So I created a DigitalOcean account last week. I invited a few people who were interested to participate in it, mainly Gavin and Damien, I think. So the plan is to provision an additional mirror and to provision a small Kubernetes cluster to use with the to use in our CI infrastructure. We are looking for some help here to write the Terraform code to provision those resources. I know that DigitalOcean has pretty good support with Terraform. And so we would like to do it the correct way initially. So yeah, if someone is interested to participate here, and that's definitely a place where you can help. So yeah, feel free to reach out to Damien. I think that you may have some time to work on it. Still related to the mirror, I started working on Rackspace to remove the machine. So we have a machine running on Rackspace. I provision everything on the new Oracle cloud environment. The machine is running, updating on itself, which is great. We are almost ready to deprovision the one running on Rackspace. So the only thing is I'm changing a little bit the way we push artifact to the service. So previously we were doing a push approach from a machine named package.jenkins.io. We would upload every artifact to the archive, the jenkins.io machine. And now the approach is a little bit different. We just pull all the artifact available from a nursing server. And right now that server is the OSUSN mirror. So that's the main difference. So the idea is we are now able to just add more mirror very easily to the pool. And so we still have to decide where we deploy those new mirror, but the idea is to have small mirrors and to have more of them in different region. The good thing with the one on Oracle is it's pretty cheap. I think it was something like $30 per month. I still have to see the cost for the network bandwidth, but that's the current state there. If some people also have experience using Terraform and Oracle, that's also a place where we could help. For the first machine, we just did manual provisioning, just went to the user interface and configure everything. But for more machines, we would like to do a better setup so people can contribute to that environment using Terraform again. Is it right for all of you? Sounds great. The next step is the brief updates on CI.Jenkins.io. I think that Damien is ready to talk on it if you want.
Yes. As a matter of fact, I would like to operate tomorrow, ideally, or Thursday, to apply the change. The thing is that we are on in a situation where the Puppet code has a lot of issues going on. Some have an impact on production, so others have an impact on the ability to locally test the code. And I would add to these two kind of issues the fact that we have a time to production which is still slowed down because we are still using the staging branch. That means if we try to deploy a new big change like this one on CI Jenkins.io, our ability to iterate locally and efficiently to fix the issue could be put at risk. So my proposal is that in order to be sure outside the classic, on the hypothesis that the classical review process goes well, that there is no hidden thing cooked by you folks when reviewing my pull request, I would like to get rid of the staging branch tomorrow morning as a first mandatory step before going forward, just to be sure that once we merge a pull request on the Jenkins infra repo, then it's merged and deployed to production immediately.
On that one, I totally support that move because definitely the problem that we have here is when we want to do a change, we first have to merge the change to the staging branch and then we have to just create a PR from the staging branch to the production branch, and it's only deployed to the it's only deployed in production. And I had a look at it in the past. We were testing every staging branch on Amazon. So in the past, we were provisioning Amazon infrastructure, testing the deployment there, and then put it on that infrastructure. This is something that we stopped doing a long time ago. So right now, we just don't use the staging. I mean, it's just a way to slow down us. So I totally support that. I'm just not sure if we want to switch to the default branch prediction or just use a different branch. Maybe prediction since the 01.
Yeah, one step after the other. Right now, I want to remove staging from the equation because changing the name of the production branch could have impact on the Puppet master. So that should be a change if we upgrade that should be a separated change. So once we have that one, I will feel totally okay and safe to go forward. So if everyone is okay on the review and we can remove that, I should be able to deploy the CI Jenkins.io agent configuration. So that's the cool part. And obviously there have been, and something I want to mention here, we have merged today something on staging that will be deployed to production as well. There are issues on the Puppet code that I cooked. They might be there for a reason, but also I think they are there by accident. And I want to be sure with everyone that we are aware that that can put the stability of CI Jenkins.io at risk when I will deploy this. That's why I want to group the operation on a single one. What happened is that CI Jenkins.io run on a container, which is run with the UID 999. I don't know why we don't use the default Jenkins user. And since the recent event, I'm still wondering. My assumption is because there is already a user 1000 on the host machine, and we don't expect that user to be able to read the Jenkins home.
To be honest, I think the reason was I think initially it was not using a Docker image. I'm wondering if we were not using the Ubuntu package and it was using the UID 999. I mean, a long time ago. That would be my guess here.
Which relates to the second issue. The default home user and most of the Puppet code is using a Jenkins home path, which is the path of the Jenkins home on the host virtual machine file system. So sometimes it's correct, but sometimes it's a parameter passed inside the container where the mount point is different. It's not var lib Jenkins, but var Jenkins home. So that's why we have on CI Jenkins.io, at least on the Puppet run, some errors every time. Like, for instance, when trying to install plugins, the idempotent CLI, that was suffering a bunch of issues, including that one, because it was not using the correct path, so unable to locate the Jenkins CLI jar file, because it was a not existing path. Also, the default user running the Jenkins controller on CI Jenkins.io has a home directory that doesn't exist. Currently, it's set to var lib Jenkins because of that bug on the Puppet code. And I understand it comes from it was running with the package, and when it was shifted to Docker container, it did not follow the Docker container precept. So I tried to fix this element. Tim and Olivier have reviewed that, but I might have forgotten or broken something. In particular, I tried to be careful on the user ID. I tested and reproduced with the Vagrant box, where I made sure that there were different UID between the default 1,000 user on the machine, the 1,000 of the username Jenkins inside the container. And I was using a third one to have the same topology. It was working well, but still we might have different behaviors. Also, that can have an impact on Trusted. Trusted has the same pattern, except it's not 999, it's something else, which is not 1,000, which is not 1,001. So both might have issues due to that change, but we have to fix these errors. I mean, it's not acceptable that we have a Puppet agent that throws error on production. The errors are purely ignored, but we have to fix that.
I think that pair has been merged. I mean, I'm currently looking at this pair.
Yes. And the upcoming pair with the CI cask also embeds the things that you underline, Olivier.
Okay.
Which is we use the command line on the host, a shell script named idempotent CLI, which role is to run either install plugin on Jenkins, run a Groovy script for the lockbox, or safe restart Jenkins at the end. These are the three actions that I identify that command run. How does it work? It does a Docker exec inside the container, locate the Jenkins CLI.jar, and connect through the CLI to localhost to Jenkins to trigger the actions. So the safe restart and the Groovy execution must be working. So that's why I kept the existing behavior and I only fixed the issue to reuse. And that's an idea from Olivier on the initial pull request. I've added a new change, which is not merged yet, that will use the new Jenkins plugin CLI, which is part of the Docker image for the plugin installation. But I specify the Jenkins home as destination instead of user Jenkins ref. The reason being, what if the Jenkins process is down? For instance, gcask, read the file, and somehow during the startup sequence fails because there is a plugin which is not present. That's the case I had. In theory, Jenkins cask should fail the startup of Jenkins, but the API should still be available on localhost. However, some edge cases, it doesn't work. That means sometimes you can have Jenkins failing, the container is up, Jenkins prints a big error stack due to config as code because missing plugin. And what you want is the idempotent CLI to install the missing plugin because we forget that we had to mention this one. And then you are stuck unless you manually put the GPI plugin and restart force restart Jenkins. So to avoid that edge case that Olivier identified, I'm using Jenkins plugin CLI because you only need the container to be running and it's completely independent from Jenkins. And okay, it's also a good use of that new tool. So that's also something that changed. So there is a big bunch of changes, and I would like to try them tomorrow morning if all the process review is okay. Yep.
Tomorrow morning is a little bit dangerous because it's the 2.289.3 LTS build day.
Oh, it's tomorrow. I thought it was next week. Okay, perfect.
So if you or Tim would be willing to start that build early your time. So if you were to start your day and
just to be sure, that does not affect the release C.ci environment.
While it does not. If we affected trusted, that would block the Docker containers. And it makes me a little nervous. If we could just get through the process of building 2.289.3, and it's really only about 4 hours. So Damien, if you were to launch the 2.289.3 build as you arrive at work, mm-hmm. and then 4 hours later, it's probably done.
If we have to delay, I would prefer not spending my time tomorrow on that and to Thursday. One major task per day, because I can work on the Terraform, I can work on fixing other part of Jenkins Puppet code. So I don't mind. And then let's delay to Thursday. And also it will add more time to review the changes then. If it's okay for everyone.
Yes, that sounds good.
That's great for me. Olivier, you're okay with that?
Definitely.
Okay, so let me just make a note there that we'll do that Thursday instead of Wednesday. Okay. Thursday.
Okay, so I think I cover. I'm sorry, it took a bit of time, but I wanted to underline these changes so everyone is aware that if it fails in the upcoming days, I'm there. I don't plan to go on holidays, but important to inform everyone on that
topic. That's the first the purpose of these kind of discussions, just to highlight potential issues. The next topic is about, so this one that Mark, you want to bring, the Docker multi-arch progress. Did we make any progress since last week? I may miss some information here.
Yeah, so there, I think the story is quite good. We've had Docker multi-arch images on our roadmap for over a year. And now we've got nice progress, thanks to Tim Jacome and to Damien Duportal, on actually implementing multi-arch support. So thanks to Tim's work for implementing Docker BuildX Bake and Damien's work for implementing parallel testing, we've got a significantly faster build process for our Linux images. Thank you to both of them. There's more to do there and more to continue, and we've got work that will continue. Damien, maybe you want to give more color and more, but it's good, and we've still got the proposal in play to switch those Docker images for the August 28th 2.302.1 LTS release from using JDK 8 to using JDK 11. I'll get a JEP submitted late this week that's proposing that and has a pretty detailed plan trying to describe what we need to do.
Yep. The only hiccups here that we discovered today during today's weekly process is that the publication of these new images that we wanted to try to do during that weekly failed for little minor hiccups, but we have to reproduce and fix them. So right now we only build and test. We don't deploy, publish these images for now.
So Damien, just to be clear then, so today's 2.304 will still publish a Docker image, but it won't be multi-arch.
Exactly. That is
okay,
correct.
Great. Thank you. Okay, that's good.
If I understand correctly, the limitation is having access to the agent to run the multi-arch.
No, it's we have to check what is happening, because the behavior we saw on trusted is different than what we saw on CI. So we have a team on high to double check that we use exactly the same agents with the same KEMU, because we use KEMU mainly. We are not choosing yet the specific architectural images, because these static agents are connected to CI right now. So we wanted to start the first version with KEMU emulation to avoid requiring too much, let's say, exotic platform for now.
Great. Thank you. Yeah, Damien, thanks so much to you and to Tim. It's wonderful, the progress that's been made there.
And we can still make more. I have one number. So the master build branch went to 22, 25 minutes before all those changes. And now it's between 12 and 50 minutes. So we gained 10 minutes. That's a nice improvement. And if anyone is willing to help on the Windows part, so I'm going to work on this in the upcoming weeks, but this is mainly PowerShell scripting and everything is sequential. And that part is a different pattern. So we have a lot of gains. I'm sure we can gain 5 or 6 minutes more by parallelizing all the tasks during the build and test phases on Windows. So anyone interested to help there is a huge improvement to be done.
So that improvement from 25 to 12 includes the Windows improvements. I thought we were stuck at 25, but you found a way, even without doing the Windows improvements, to still cut in half the build time.
Yes, because the Windows machine are taking almost 12 to 15 minutes. That's the slowest part of the pipeline. You can see clearly on the branches. While all the other Linux, the slowest Linux are Red Hat based, and they took almost 2 minutes to build and around 2.5 minutes to test, which means the slowest Linux part is 6 minutes. So that should be... Yeah, you see the gain we can still have.
Right. So if we can make Windows builds as efficient as Linux builds, we could be down to a 6-minute build process.
Yep.
That's excellent. Okay. Thank you. That's all that I had on Docker MultiArch. I'll announce the JEP for review. It certainly needs lots of review. There were a lot of things I learned by trying to prepare the JEP that people will now tell me, oh, you misunderstood this or that.
That sounds good. I think we cover all the topics for today's meeting. Any last topic before we close the meeting? Thanks for your time, Dan, and see you in RSC.
Thanks.
Thank you.